Hey everybody, Herman Williams here. It's actually been about 10 years since I spent any time talking about grip, so I thought here in 2020 may be a good time to update that. I get a lot of questions still about some of my opinions about interlocking grip versus overlapping and why I tend to discourage the interlock grip, as well as whether a strong grip is better than a weak grip or a neutral grip and so on. So I thought I'd try to bring some fresh clarity to all of that. And I'll start right away with the interlocking grip. Let's be clear, Jack Nicklaus uses it, Tiger uses it. It has won more tournaments than I'm sure I can count. There's nothing really wrong with the interlocking grip style. And just to be clear what we're talking about, it's essentially where the lead hand, the forefinger, and then the trail hand, pinky finger, just kind of interlock into the golf club like so. The reason that I'm not a fan of that grip has more to do with kind of a natural inability to get it correct. I think it, for newer players or for higher handicap amateurs, you know, just players that maybe just aren't seasoned in the game with some guidance, the natural tendency with the interlocking style, unfortunately, the first tendency is to try to shove the forefinger and the pinky as deep together as possible. And when we see people grasp the club, what you tend to get is a grip that almost would never be useful. It's what we have will be a lead hand that's weak turned underneath the golf club, and then a trail hand that's strong turned in the other way, and now the hands are literally like in opposition to each other on the golf club. You really physically can't even hinge the wrist at that point. They'll bend sideways a little, but not as much as the correct range of movement would have you do. They just don't work well the rest of the way through the golf swing. You could chip that way and putt that way, but I think that's the last time it would be effective. If you need anything with power, I don't think it's going to be so great. So if you're an interlock player and you love that style, if you came to me one-on-one for a private lesson, I doubt I would ask you to change it. I would just make sure that you're doing it well. So when it's done well, the tips of the fingers don't mesh together very far. And kind of my favorite, sort of a pretty neutral style of a grip, is sort of mildly strong in the, as a right-handed golfer, the lead hand, where we'd say we're seeing 2.5 knuckles. You could just say the third knuckle is in view. So that lead hand's kind of in like so. And then a somewhat weaker kind of right hand where it's more on the top and centered. And that just gets the right palm facing the target, and it gets the left hand turned in sort of palm down. In a strong position that can really work in the direction of the target pretty well, and it's pretty natural to our anatomy. So that's really all I want to say about interlock. Some of you that would challenge me and say he's an idiot, you know, that's a great grip. I'll agree with you. Just be good at doing it. And if you're newer to the game, I'll warn you that the temptation is really to shove that trail hand right underneath the bottom and then struggle with what to do with the club face later. Often you'll end up with a left hand that's the other way as well. So that's that one. So now let's just assume we're in an overlap grip camp, or if you're interlocking, you've got a good one. Now what do we do with the choice? We've got kind of this neutral idea, and I want to describe neutral in my world. A lot of people think when I'm talking neutral, it's kind of weak, and I've talked about some stuff with advantages of weak grips. I think for higher handicap players, weak grip probably is dangerous in general, but for the better players, sometimes if there's a lot of activity in closing the face, it can be a safer kind of grip. But let's just stick with middle of the road, kind of a neutral conversation about it. So I like when you would grasp the club over at your lead side, you get that lead hand turned in a little bit, get the palm on top, or the heel pad on top, I'm sorry, and bring it to the front of the body. If you're pretty neutral, your thumb is going to be just off of 12 o'clock. I'll move in a little closer to the camera here so you can see the grip logo down the center. I've got my thumb just off the center. This V is kind of at the right side of my face or ear, and I'm kind of in that 2.5 knuckle window. Now, once you lay the club on the ground, you may not be able to see any of that stuff, so I advise people, don't try to peek down here to check how your grip's doing. Look at it up here at about belt buckle height. And the right hand would come in. The lifeline in the palm tends to cover the thumb. Trigger finger will be right on the back of the shaft. Pinky lays over, and we're in like so. So that's pretty vanilla neutral. Now, what do we want to do when we're arguing what kind of grip we want. You know, I'm going to tell you it all depends on your ability to move through the top of the swing and in a pre-impact position. So if I go pre-impact right now, I can tell you that universally on tour now, we're seeing more so than ever a tendency to have the leading edge of the blade when the club's about waist high. That leading edge is a pretty good proxy or a match for kind of the torso angle. In other words, if I bow over 30 degrees and I've got about 30 degrees of tilt in that face coming into the ball. Now it changes with each club. You know, a driver shaft's on a longer, flatter plane. It may not tilt down as much as a wedge, but in general, if we went back 50 years, we might see a lot of guys coming in and ladies on the LPGA coming in with this real flat looking shaft, the back of the hand up, face kind of up towards the sky, which is a very open position that would require a rapid either bowing in the wrist or a full on rollover of the forearms. And we're seeing less and less of that style out on the tour now. So with grip choice, you want to start thinking about how you want to feel both at top of backswing and in this pre-impact position. So this fairly neutral grip is going to definitely require the flat left wrist, which I've talked heavily about in the past, and a very bent right wrist. And you need to be comfortable with that. You need to be able to do it. And then from there, as you'd move down into the downswing, those wrists are going to sort of change position. Now the left one is on the bottom, the back of the hand kind of facing down, right palm kind of on top, pressuring down the shaft, and again, pointing that face down. And I don't want this video to move off into how to release the golf club and club positions and all that. I just want to tell you how the grip will fit into that. So if you think that's your program, then go for that relatively neutral grip. You probably won't have quite as much wrist hinge at the top of the swing, but I don't think we need a ton of that to be effective. So let's say now maybe you're thinking, well, Herman, I want to max out my distance, you know, give me a grip that's going to really give me a lot of power and so on. So, or you've got a certain kind of pre-impact and release style that you're looking at. So strong grip, we're just going to be talking about both hands as a right-handed player would be turned to the right. We've now exaggerated this over to three or four knuckles in view. And we'll go ahead and embrace the idea that we're going to let the right hand slip in there kind of underneath it as well, so that both palms are kind of turned to the right, both V's are headed out to this right shoulder or maybe even farther. Now at this point, it's going to be pretty dangerous if you've got the rolling release from your past or have any tendencies to do that. But one advantage with that kind of grip is you can get to the top of the swing with a little bit of cupping, kind of a little dish shape in that left wrist, which provides a little more range of movement for hinging to get a little bit more swing speed, or at least club speed, I should say. It allows you to come into the impact area. I don't have to turn the back of my hand full on downward or get, some people feel this is pretty uncomfortable to get the bowing in the wrist to get the face down in a good position. I can actually, as you're looking down the line right now, the face is fine. And the back of my hand is definitely turned up more than that previous weaker grip, which was a neutral grip, would have looked. Okay, so this swing is going to feel a little bit more like how you might come in striking a baseball. We definitely come in kind of side on with the hands coming into a baseball, more side on with the way the forearm is going to move into the hit. And a lot of people show up in this sport naturally kind of predisposed to come in that way. And they can't understand why they slice everything so bad. They've got maybe kind of a normal, pretty neutral grip, come in sideways, slice the ball. And then rather than figuring out a way to fix the face, they typically just start coming over the top and letting the path help pull that golf ball back online. And yeah, it doesn't end up being a very good solution. So back to the strong grip, if you know, and I don't mind trying to go experiment with both. I mean, sometimes you have to try couple of different things to decide that's not really my cup of tea. This one over here is a little bit better. But on this one, again, the V's out here on the right shoulder, the style matchups, that's really the key thing. I should have used that term earlier in this video lesson, that you're always trying to, anything you're putting or building into your swing has got to match up with other places in the swing. You get all the styles to match up and it works pretty well. So that kind of style matchup, again, backswing, club face will look about like what we're expecting for downswing, but the back of my left hand is facing more upward this time. top of the swing. I don't have to be quite as worried about being flat to bowed. I don't have as much right wrist bending back. A little bit more cuppy look right in here at the top. See a few more wrinkles in the gap there. But as I'm coming down, I'm still looking for that same positioning in the face. Probably I would admit that to me the wrists feel more relaxed here. They're not having to try as hard to get things turned down. You might like that feel. Impact from there, we're just easily going to move in through this position and clear the body, but the exit is key now. If you've got the strong grip, you can't let things roll right in here in the impact zone. You're going to need to keep moving your body and keep letting the golf club swing out in front of you. Any kind of feel of a rollover or whatever kind of release feel you want to have needs to be laid. And you may decide, well, okay, I don't feel that mobile through there. If that's the case, then that grip may not feel as safe for you. But, you know, start exploring. You know, think about how your style matchups are going to work. Does your grip fit the type of top of backswing position that you want to have? Does it fit the kind of pre-impact position that you want to have? Does it fit the release style that you want to have? Okay, so I suspect the question you have now is, Herman, what is going to be the best grip for me? And, you know, I could answer that most easily, you know, probably without being too self-promotional. If you were to contact me for an online lesson or come to see me in North Carolina, it's a no-brainer for me to kind of help you with that. But here on YouTube, let me just give you some advice. I want you to be using the grip that most easily lets you square the face and hit the fewest blocks to the right, hooks to the left, or you know, whatever your mishit pattern is going to tend to be. And the other thing I'd say about the grip is establish a grip that doesn't have you fighting your own anatomy. So I'll at least give you my own preference for grip, and it's kind of changed a little bit over the years. 20 years ago, I would have been in a fairly neutral to weakish grip, very flat to almost bowed wrist here, laying the club down in a lot like a Ben Hogan, and then with more of a rolling release. Now, Hogan didn't necessarily roll it. I think once we got better video, we realized he wasn't doing everything the way we've heard. But to just get to the point, without fighting anatomy. So as we would stand here relaxed, most of us, the lead arm is going to turn in a pretty significant amount. And I want to try to match that lead hand pretty close to the way your own arm hang looks. So, you know, you establish that grip, you get that heel pad on top, you get that thumb a little bit off-centered here, and then it'd be good if you could get an assistant to come over and literally pull on the club head where it just pulls your arm out straight with some force, like the weight of the golf club at 80 miles an hour, 100 miles an hour is going to be pulling on your arm. And you want to feel like, would the face be square in that position? Because there's a lot of torques in the swing, there's the weight of the club pulling out. But the other one is we're changing direction almost, you know, the sheer position of the club at the top wants to torque that lead arm down this way and essentially make the face behave open. The rapid unwinding of the body tends to want to make that happen. And then any elbow drive in the trail arm. So there are a lot of things that would naturally, with good athletic movement, try to lay the club down and open it up. And you've got to be able to fight that off some way, either through grip or manipulations in the wrist. So, you know, the bottom line here is this lead hand, this lead arm, need to really be able to control that. So I'm an advocate now of a stronger grip than I would have been in the past. For myself, I'll really say that third knuckle is in view. I've got the thumb out of the center. It's now over, you know, depending on how you're looking at a clock face, it's 1 o'clock or 11 o'clock, depending on your vantage point of looking at the clock. But there's that, and you know, trying to sense how easily you're going to be able to get that club face in this kind of position. Because I'm looking for personally, I feel like the best release method would be the least amount of forearm rotation, the least club face twist going through the golf ball. So to just speed up the conversation, I like to grasp the club over here at the side of the body because that's where that arm is going to hang pretty natural. That lets that hand turn inward, clinch it there, get that heel pad on top, bring it over to the center, and then just place the trail hand on so the palm is basically facing the target. So, you know, you could kind of call it a strong left and then neutral right. And that's going to let the hand positions come into a really solid impact, a really solid top of the backswing that's pretty vanilla, middle of the road, with kind of a, I'll call it a slap shot style release where the right wrist is fully bent back here. It's going to be straightening as it's moving through the hit to here. So it's a release pattern that gets the club to unload, but doesn't necessarily get the face to roll. So that's my favorite way to grip it, but you know, there might be a lot of subtle nuances to how we would ask an individual to do that. And feel free, if that's something you want to pursue, to contact me online, get with me for an online lesson, or make a trip to North Carolina. We'll be glad to help you out with it.